So this is Eggleston Hall Gardens, and over the past year we've taken you on a journey of what it's like to run a nursery garden. I'm getting a sense of deja vu here, Thomas. The Royal Horticultural Society have said we are in crisis. The industry is lacking youngsters coming through. This is Eggleston Hall Gardens, and over the next 12 months, we're going to take you on a journey of what it's like to run a nursery garden. Good morning to another week of fun and excitement. I hope that's sounding proper garden presentery. Anyway, it is week 50. We've just been through the bulbs, and we have to keep an eye on them every week or two and check the mouse boxes, of which we had 5 mice and 2 short-tailed field voles that would normally be feeding on our plants. Buggers. But they aren't now. Plenty of stuff is coming through. Almost everything is coming through. And I'm quite pleased with that. Having a little look here. The thing is, one bulb looks much the same as another. Little iris reticulatas. They will make lovely little plants for the spring. Assuming we have some customers this spring. They were all looking fantastic last year, and we weren't allowed anyone in. The nibs are looking really tired. There's plenty up on the wall as well, but they're now dormant. I don't know what they are, Thomas. They look like pots of liverwort to me. I'm sure there's something underneath them. Pulmoniums, schizostylus, hellebores, a lot of the stuff needs cleaning up. Just to, when we get some people back here, we'll get these things down the bottom and clean off the liverwort at the top. We need to let some air around the roots. But there's no hurry before Christmas. We'll do it in January so that when we get into the new year, the stuff can get off to a flyer. January and February around here are notoriously awful months. Everything's sleeping now. Well, I wish I was, to be honest, but I'm not. Even though it's the first half of December, you can see that this is a Chiel's weeping. Weeping cherry. And there's another one there, I can't remember what that one is, but they're only just dropping their leaves. It's they seem to be hanging on to them for just hanging on to them much longer than normal. These are delphiniums. They're going to need weeding and top dressing, and the bed needs clearing. We call this bed 23. We call it that because it's the 23rd bed. Not very original, is it? Oh, Pep. Here! What's this? Hey, good find. Daft as a bag of bollocks. Over on the base of the wall, we have some young rhododendrons, they're coming on really quite nicely. And young azaleas, viburnums, more little rhododendrons, and there's some pretty little plants there. We put out these mechanopsis yesterday. Just out the way up here really. And the camellias, young camellias, looking really nice. We have a problem this year, and that the country has a massive rose situation. We're not able to get any roses. We normally get them from David Austin's, and they're saying to us, well, we don't know what we're going to have left. We never did the budding last year as much because of furlough and COVID. So there's all sorts of problems. And no, it seems to be universal right around the country. I think a lot of it is due because the wholesalers that supply us with 1,000 roses every year, or other nurseries, they're actually selling direct to the public now and growing them and selling them, rather than going through the wholesale market and us producing them retail. I do them because I don't like dealing with roses. So we get them as a finished product from David Austin. It's the only real thing that we get as a finished product. But I'm hoping that a fellow nurseryman over in Pickering is going to be able to help us out with some this year, because all the nice ones, it looks like we're not going to be able to get. Currently, Lisa is ploughing through a list of roses. We don't really do hybrid teas or floribundis, but there's some nice of the old-fashioned roses, the Gallicas, the Bourbons, and Ian Rogers has quite a few of those. Now, you can see here where we're starting with the maiden trees. Thomas and I got the apples out yesterday, up and all tied in. So you can see they will just sit here through the summer, and they will break away. We've pruned it there, and the top buds will all, as I've said before, they'll all try and become the new leader, and they should hopefully produce 4 or 5 nice new shoots that will form the head of the tree. This is the apples. At the moment I've got to start work this morning on plums, but it's just me and Pepper. And frankly, Pepper's potted is absolutely atrocious. Where are you? Where's she gone? She's buggered off somewhere. Oh, there you are. Come here. Go find the mouse. Where's the mouse? It's mousing time. In there. Is there any in there, Pep? No? Oh. No, you're not too interested in that one. You go down to the next one. Wait, what's wrong with that one? Is that one? Are you not going to look at that one? Oh well, obviously nothing in that one. It seems every morning it's really Pepper that likes to do the walkabout. See what goes on. I probably wouldn't do it every day, but she likes to check round everywhere. She used to want to know the far end of her fart. Pepper, everything's all right in here. You come in. Come on. Let's go. What's through there? Nothing in there? No. You want me to check that one out? Oh well, that's the morning perusal over. So much work. This is one of the reasons it's good to have a wander around. Not that that's Pepper's reason for doing it. But one of the reasons that you can just get a sense of the work that's got to be done. When we get the staff back after New Year, there is such a lot of work to do. And, you know, we start getting people in around the end of February. So we have to be geared up for that. And this year we have so many perennials coming in. We can't produce enough now because we've had quite a... You know, people have got into their gardening a bit and we've sold too many perennials. A lot of next year's stock. So we're going to have to get some from friends and fellow nurserymen and things. We try and... we don't get anything from overseas. We only get some from British growers. And the important thing is we get the rarer stuff. The stuff that the garden centres don't do. I'm not sure what they're going to be able to do after January, to be honest, because it won't affect us, but I'm not sure how the bringing in of stuff and the tariffs are going to go when... Well, nobody seems to know at the moment, this, as of this week, what's going on with the European thing, whether we're part of the European market. Business-wise, I couldn't give a toss. Makes no difference to me. But I know there are other companies that it does, and they probably don't want it on the top of furlough, COVID. All these new words, I'm just not able to keep up with them. It's I'm just pleased. I'm probably going to be out of it in another 9 months. Half past nine. Been here an hour, haven't done bugger all. It's scone time, isn't it? Are you wanting your bit of scone? You can't have any currants, you know. I like them. Oh, God. Every morning at 10:15, you have to be here, don't you? It's tea time. How do they know? She hasn't got a watch. She can't read the time. But at 10:15 exactly, she stood by the door. And if I'm not there... She has to get round the potting shed and remind me with a little wine. You're bloody ruined, you know. You're ruined. You are. You're ruined. In between times, it's now all about cleaning places and cleaning spaces. And Thomas really is the space maker general. It's all about getting these spaces ready so that we can condense up the plants and they can sit quietly somewhere. All pushed together, and then we will work on them, repot them, feed them, and then put them straight back out in the new clean and tidy spaces. That's husbandry. That's good husbandry for the coming year. These empty pots here are delphiniums. You go, remember we did all those delphinium crown buds? So let's have a little look at one and see what's in the pot. There. They don't look very exciting on top, but underneath, plenty of root. And come the about March time, they'll be flying away. Let's just check some of the ones that definitely look like there's nothing on them. There we are, plenty of root. You can go back to, I assume, July, and see how we did those crown buds. Oh, these are all named varieties of delphinium. But I'm just showing you to prove to you that it works really well. Put the root on that. It is the most effective. There's more of them here. Hundreds of them. And here. They don't look very exciting, but as I've said, that stuff's resting. Sweet peas, week 50, there's no need to come back to these now. You can see how they're doing. They will sit here through the rest of this winter. And you've seen how we grow autumn sown sweet peas. They will take any amount of cold weather. It really won't hurt them, but you will get fantastic plants. Lavenders, they will just sit quite happily and break into growth. We'll move those again in the new year. Obviously we won't be filming this series in the new year, but we will be moving them up and probably up to the wall, and they'll sit nicely at the end of the wall. Sorry if my fingers were in the way just now. It's difficult to film things when without somebody else to help you. Well, at least you don't get to see my ugly mug, which is a bonus in anybody's eyes. So we're approaching the middle of December. I don't know what the date is, I just know it's December. The pittosporums are looking really good. I expect to sell lots of those during the summer. These formiums are looking excellent. It's always so important to keep stuff on the dry side. They're developing a really nice colour, which means they're happy. You have to be very careful. It's very easy to overwater things like that, especially this time of the year. The thing is that because there isn't any heat, stuff isn't transpiring. It's not using up the moisture, so the moisture just sits in the pot and then rots off the roots. There's an agapanthus in flower there. It shouldn't be, but plants do that sometimes. There's that really nice ceanothus. Now, you know ceanothus, the Californian lilac. I think it's called blue sapphire. Well, there's one or two others now. It has this really, really dark foliage. Yeah, blue sapphire. And it's very effective. You know, if you grow it against a light coloured wall or a light coloured background. Very nice. And I saw somebody had put one recently against a sambucus. They must have bought it off us a few years back, and it was a good size now. And they grew it against their golden sambucus, Sutherland's Gold. And the contrast between the really dark foliage and the gold foliage was really noticeable, marked, and it was impressive. And what I mean about concentrating plants up is, as with these larger hollies, and these trees, not all the trees are concentrated up, but they're all put nice and tightly together. And they sit there while we clean off these beds. You can pile stuff up quite, or take it down to the potting shed ready. There's the first stuff we're going to work on. And then the beds can be cleaned off and they're nice and fresh and busting with vigour. They can come back on. Same will happen to all these perennials. I'm telling you this rather than showing you because we have only 2 or 3 weeks and we may not get round to it before this series is over. So we have all of these perennials will be taken down, condensed up. We will put some in the glass house there. We've been selling some off cheap in there, some that we've got too many of. That bloody pheasant. That's Randy Andy, I think. I've wandered off. What was I saying? Yeah, we put them in the glasshouse. There's a few things we're growing off cheap in there. Well, we put some in there so that if there is a couple of degrees of frost, we can actually work on them while they don't freeze up, because it's very hard to work on stuff when it's frozen. Certain jobs, like putting the main labels on the fruit trees that and the maiden trees that we're growing at the moment, we won't put the tie-on labels on because it's quite a long job. We'll leave that for a day when the ground is frozen or we can't work on stuff. It doesn't happen so much in recent years. We don't get the deep penetrating frosts for a number of years now. Not really any really long periods of freeze since about 2010, I would say. We've had a period of 2 or 3 days, but that's all. Yeah, each of these have to have a tie-on label, so there you are. That's our start of the week wander around. We'll see what else it brings. I have to tell you that it's due to piddle with rain for the next 3 or 4 days. I'm only here for 3 days, so possibly 4 if I can't break the back of these maiden trees. The old beech tree, it has so much moss growing on it. It has hollies growing out of the base and grass. It has water pooling in the bottom. This is it's just such an incredible thing. Unfortunately, it has lots of fungus growing up it, in it, over it, around it. It is a it's just a host for all sorts of things. You can see there are bulbs coming through all along the base there. Foxgloves, hollies. I don't know how many more years it's got to add on to its 400. But it is a marvellous, marvellous tree. And I feel privileged to have spent a quarter of a century in its presence. Pepper, Pepper, come out, come out. No, no. You'll have found a hedgehog nest.
Okay, well here are all, well, not all of them, but some of our deceptums that should have been potted this year, but due to COVID, we didn't buy any soil in or any pots, so they're gonna have to wait till the spring now. That's filigree, it's got a lovely green bark over the winter, and it's got a really pretty deceptive leaf in the spring. Yeah, they've all been sat here, desperate to be repotted, but they're just ridiculous in the pots they're in. Aces do like to be in smaller pots, but they're just really desperate to be potted on in the spring. So I think it might even be as early as February. These are all seedlings, just picked out for their colour or leaf form, which is generally the ordinary Acer palmatum, but they do give you a nice colour, as well as the grafted ones really. These are some of the deceptums that we're going to plant up. They did get badly chewed, a lot of them. We had a rabbit problem in the tunnels, albeit in the square tunnel. Because that grass path is in there, they tend to come in there. They actually dig their way through, or they go through the polythene to get to the grass. But at one point over the winter, a couple of years ago, we weren't on the ball, and the doors were shut for the couple of months in the winter when we don't get any customers. And they actually ringed as far as they could reach. They sit on the pot and they'd ring the height of themselves. So this is why we've got these rounds, because they will. We've got a naughty fox that actually makes a hole in the tunnel polythene in the covers at the bottom, to get the jelly tots that we put for the mouse traps. But if we don't keep up with checking where the holes are, then the rabbits will get in. So we've covered these just to be on the safe side, even though some of them have been chewed. But we're going to plant them where Matthew's cleared. Not all of them, but varieties we're short of. Mind you, we're always short of Deceptums. Ah, there you are. There's a fresh foxhole in the corner of the bottom of the tunnel. He's chewed his way through the polythene, which probably doesn't take him very long, to be fair, to get the jelly tots off the mouse traps. Well, this is one that was chewed a couple of years ago, and amazingly, it's still alive. What they do is they destroy the Cambrian layer, the rabbits, when they chew them. That's not too high, but it has actually left, you can see the knobbly bits, has actually left like a channel of a Cambrian layer. So the top is actually getting fed by the bottom, by the root system. But unfortunately, that is not saleable now. Nobody wants a chewed Acer. So that'll be one that we'll plant up and hopefully produce us, even if it only goes on for a few years, it will produce us quite a few scions to use for the grafting in the summer. It won't be this coming year, but maybe next year they'll be growing away well enough. Yeah, it really does totally spoil the whole look of them. It's what we're up against, fighting the wildlife all the time. If it's not the rabbits, it's the foxes or the deer or the mice and sometimes rats. But there, never mind. It's part and parcel with the business, isn't it? Well, in here it was about 2 foot high in weeds, and Sophie, bless her, has been in here most of the week taking out all the weeds and tidying up. And she's been accompanied again by her robin. There's a little bird feeder there. She puts mealworms in, and he comes and feeds off there. Keeps her company. Mostly people know the Acer palmatum family, Japanese maples, because of their enormous range of leaf forms and also their good colours. But not often is it thought that they've got very unusual barks. This is one of our stock plants, Nishikigawa. It's got the really rough cork bark. As it matures, the young grafts haven't always got this on them. They take a few years to mature. So we get asked for this quite a lot. Nishikigawa. It's not only the barks either, because it's the forms when the leaf comes off in the winter. Some of them are so beautiful. This one's Kayaheim, and it's just a mass of branches. It's really pretty, doesn't get too big. Gosh, I can't remember how old this one is, but they still look good without any leaves on, planted in the right place. I was just coming past our Acer palmatum dissectum viridis, and the light's just caught the top of the branches. It looks really pretty. It's been raining, and it's got the raindrops just hanging on the branches. Oh yeah, you can just see them, just like a Christmas tree that's been decorated. It's very pretty. It's just how the light catches it. Even when there's no leaves on some of the maples, as you can see, they look really good. So all the contortion shows up. You wouldn't necessarily see that when that's in full leaf. The light just glinting on the top. It's really pretty.
It was quite a reasonable day when we set off. It's absolutely peddling down now. We're in the forest at the moment, but in a minute we'll pull out onto the moors, and in a few minutes. and it'll be whistling up the Kyburn Pass there. Come on, you two. Three. Come on. No more. You've had enough. Come on. The gamekeeper saw this. He'd be worried sick that the dogs were after his young pheasants or whatever. In actual fact, come on! They're interested in the rats. They should be paying me to keep the rats down. Come on, you buggers. What's this? Find this. These are rats. Come on. Yeah, you little. The troublesome threesome. And I picked up along the way some old vagrant tramp. There it is. Hello, vagrant tramp.
You're a bit dirty.
Do you want a blanket or something? You know.
I like a blanket on my legs.
We are just out over the moor.
Yeah, getting me dirty. It's getting me dirty.
Yeah.
My bum's already dirty.
Yeah, we don't want to see your bum. This is a garden video, not a very porn video. There, look at that. Thermal inversion. Really spooky to see the cloud in the bottom of the valley like that. Right, obviously we can't come up here with the tractor, so we come in through the top door, coming there. Thomas is just bringing them in now. The good thing about a track around the back here is that at least in the winter we can use it, because to bring up these 10-12 litre pots on a wheelbarrow uphill would be knackering. You can explain what you're doing, Thomas.
Yep. So I just got myself some fresh spring roll. End up tying them into the swung. Just tying these by the cane when they've got the rabbit guard on, but we're just trying to give them plenty of space as well. I'm trying to put them all on the same side of the rope, and also, as you can see, so we try to put them in, like, alternate them a bit so they sort of go in some sort of a zigzag fashion, just try and maximise the space for them, because although they don't look a lot, you think we're probably leaving too much space considering they're a twig. They do put on so much growth in a year. Some of these side shoots can come out more than a foot, can't they?
Yeah, it's two sometimes.
So yeah. It's just a question of giving them plenty of space and anticipating the growth that you're going to get from them. Obviously, there'll end up being gaps in this with ones selling as well, because although they are maidens, we talk about them as if they are for next year. We do actually sell a lot of these in the first year because they make such smart little trees, and they're ideal for people for training at this sort of age as well.
Yeah, of course, if you want to train something as an espalier or a fan, then you can prune it lower down, and then they break lower down, and then you can train in your arms or your fans. Yeah. It is a sense of deja vu, isn't it?
It is,
what
yeah.
We take for granted, we it just seems normal, a part of life.
Yeah. And we'll run them through. We start off with the pears, then we go to the apples, then we might stick in some of the miscellaneous things, like we've got some apricots and some peaches this year, then probably cherries and plums, and then we'll have the ornamentals tagged on to the end.
Yeah.
There's not as many ornamentals, but still quite a lot.
Sold so many this year. So at the moment I'm just doing these still doing these plums. The first thing I need to do is prune them out. There is no point of all these lower branches. As with the apples, you want your head to start further up. What I am going to do is just cut them back to a couple of buds. really just to strengthen the stem. And then around April, May time, I'll go back and cut them back to the main stem. So we're just going to trim these up all the way. Now, that is way too tall. We don't want the head starting right up there. If we wanted to have it as a huge standard tree, we could nip it back there. But we want the head to start somewhere lower down. This is the head, is where the branches begin. So I think we'll probably have it at around about 4 to 5 feet, about there. So that should come out from there. That lets you get underneath it and able to do things. And then we'll trim these little feathers back around about April, May time. And then it's just a question of potting them. Now, the plums just have bigger roots than the apples. You can see here, their roots are quite wide. So we're using for them to give them, and they have a bit more vigor. So we're putting them into poly bags. And if there is anything that's a pain in the ass, it's potting into poly bags. Getting the roots in and around. You could use much bigger rigid pots, but frankly the cost of those is quite prohibitive. Although, having said that, they are reusable. So we've got that in there. And then we just a few scoops of compost. It really eats up compost, bare rooted trees. But we need plenty of compost. Despite my disparaging remarks about poly bags, I have found over the years that so many plants don't look better, but grow better in poly bags. And that goes for perennials as well. And not everything, but the vast majority of things, if you put them in a poly bag, they seem to grow much better. The problem is, customers don't really like them. They don't sit nicely, and they're just aesthetically less pleasing. But if I had to make a decision here, I would say that plants grow better in them for sure. It is then really about hammering them down. You have to get that soil down around the roots. That is about that. And then it's just a process of putting a nice cane in just to keep it rigid, as we did with the apples. Life is made so much easier by having a max tapener that actually works well. Cuts down on the frustrations and the bad language, by extension, the bad language. Frustrations, usually. Well, actually, not always. Lack of vocabulary, perhaps, on top. There you go. One plum ready and waiting to go. That is a plum called Opal. Nice plum. It's sort of like the new Victoria, a more modern variety of Victoria. Probably a better plum. Depends on your viewpoint. People like the romance of growing old varieties like Victoria. But there you are, that's Opal. Next up, Blue Tit.
Right, so we've got all this stuff in this polytunnel, the one that we call Longshanks polytunnel. And if you can remember, a lot of this stuff, such as the eucalyptus, we were all putting these on before they came in, so that there's no chance that they'll end up droughting off over the winter if they're in too small a pot and they become impossible to water. Now, we normally, with things like the magnolias, we often don't like to do some of the deciduous things before they come in. Potting them on, that is, in case it just messes with them a little bit in terms of the sequence of events they have to go through. Because, I mean, you can see with some things like these calistemini even, and some of those euonymus, with potting them on, they actually put on a late little flush of fresh growth. Now, being inside, they'll be absolutely fine. And they're not really out of sequence. But there's these here. These are Ribes speciosum, sometimes called the Californian fuchsia. Now, it's not fully hardy up here, at least. I've seen it growing down south perfectly fine. It's a beautiful Ribes with lovely, really, really unusual flowers. Not, well, where it gets its name from, not unlike a little fuchsia flower. But these are meant to be deciduous. Now, they got potted on before they came in because, sort of, towards the end of last year, they got a bit stressed and droughted off and shed the leaves. Maybe a few weeks earlier than they would have ordinarily. But potting them in and bringing them inside has actually brought them into life. Now, this, we don't want this, funnily enough. Because obviously if we got hard frost, there's a very good chance it'll knacker these. Because obviously, although these are undercover, I mean, you can see how open the sides are. Because in the winter, we here like stuff to be able to breathe still. But, yeah, and it probably doesn't help that at the minute, apart from like a cold snap last week, we've still had a really, really mild time so far this winter. You know, I think we're at the 10th of December now, and the ground's barely been solid at all. I mean, even you've got these things like these ceanothus. I mean, ceanothus can sometimes flower twice in the same year. Now, these putrid blue are absolutely covered in bud. So, to show you that although these, as I say, they're barely undercover, it still does mess with things a little bit with the seasons. Like I say, and even these little fittinias here, just putting the stuff on, bringing it in, it just knocks it on to just go a little bit further. I mean, they'll be absolutely fine. Things like the evergreens, like these escalonias, if their new growth got frosted, they'll be absolutely fine because they've got plenty of other growth, mature growth that'll come through it. But with things like those ribes, if the entire thing got frosted, they have quite a bit of recovery work to do in that situation.
This is our Cedrus deodora. This is a variety called Roman Candle. It's a lovely thing. The new shoots in the spring, they're just white and they look just like a Roman candle. It is wonderful. I think you would have seen it earlier in the year. We keep it opposite this other weeping cryptomeria, which I've gone on about before, but I just love the way it's a foggy morning and you can see the way the raindrops just, or the fog or the dew or the mist just hangs off of each little needle just beautifully, like little jewels. It's a delightful plant, and you stand back from it. Its common name is the Japanese cedar, and you can trim back into the old wood and you can shape them up in all sorts of ways. This is the darker form, very misshapen because we have to cut it because we have to get through this path. But even with that, it just adds a bit of character. I love to see the trunk of a tree, especially when they're at windswept or given the impression of being windswept. And perhaps on this one, you can see how the mist is just clinging to the needles even better. You just look up through there. It changes from a green colour to this smoky blue or smoky sort of maroon. Really, really love this plant. Always have done since I was very young.
It's not the best of days today, weather-wise. It's inclement, to say the least. Malcolm would probably describe it in rather more fruity terms, but it's only just above freezing and it's raining solidly. So I'm sitting in my studio by the fire. I was going to talk today. The poem I've got today is actually about hellebores. And when I came here about 5 years ago, I didn't even know anything about the hellebore. But now I've discovered it. It's the most beautiful plant. They've all got their own little faces and they spend such a long period of the year in bloom or in leaf that they're just a very, very nice sight. So I told Malcolm I was going to do a little bit about hellebore. And he went upstairs to get an old book for me from one of his friends. And he brought it down because he said it had some interesting facts in it about plants. And he passed it to me and he said, "Smell that." Now, I know a number of you will probably think, "Ah, yes, something like that's happened before and it didn't end well. Surely Amanda has learnt by now." I mean, I have learned a lot of things over the years, not to wear a black bra under a white shirt and never to breathe in the potting shed if you even have the slightest hint that some of them might have had mulligatawny soup. But sometimes hope springs eternal, and so I raised the book to my face and I said, "Oh, does it have that lovely old book smell?" And Malcolm replied, baffled, "No, my friend Sue's cat once pissed on it, and I wondered if the smell was still there." It's a slow walk from the bottom to the top. Having said that, Malcolm's book does have some interesting facts in it about hellebores, and he asked me to read this bit out about Helleborus foetidus, I think I'm pronouncing that right, stinking hellebore, bearsfoot, setterwort, a native evergreen hellebore with finely cut dark green foliage and drooping pale green bell flowers. Poisonous, but hellebore was once used as a remedy for worms in children. Gilbert White commented, "Where it killed not the patient, it would certainly kill the worms. But the worst of it is, it will sometimes kill both." Blimey. Once believed to cure insanity and depression, Gerard stated that the hellebore was good for mad and furious men, for melancholy, dull and heavy persons. Also traditionally used as a remedy for cows and goats. Cattle were blessed with a hellebore to keep them from evil spells. Then it says £4.90, which frankly is a bargain. You'd think you'd landed with your bum in the butter if you bought something for that price that did all that. Anyway, onto the poem. It's by an American contemporary poet called Theodora Goss. I've only just discovered her website, and she says on it that it's okay to share her poetry on social media. I'd highly recommend you having a look at it because she's got some gorgeous work. It's really beautiful. And this one is called The Hellebore. It was January, and yet the green leaves of the hellebore still stuck out of last year's leaf mould, mostly oak and maple, edged with frost. There was frost all over the garden, rising leathery green against the brown, and underneath I could still see the pale cream buds of what eventually would become flowers like bowls of milk, the colour of a wedding gown, as soft as the cheek of a newborn, as elegant as one of those engravings from the Edo period, stylized and meaning something other than itself. Resiliency, rebirth, the promise of spring. But they did not have to mean anything in particular as I stood there admiring their tenacity. I simply wanted them to continue being themselves, and for myself to learn a little, just a little, of their endurance.
Okay, so obviously we can't come up here with the tractor to bring out, sort the maidens out. So what we have to do is come in through the back door. Wait, what are you laughing at? Hey, I'm starting again, that's disgusting.